it's a great pleasure to be part again to this event. Of course, it would have been much better to be in St. Petersburg and enjoy the White Nights, but I hope there will be opportunities soon. My name is Matteo Lambertini, a medical oncologist from the University of Genova in the northwest of Italy, and I'm particularly happy to discuss this topic, which is most of my clinical and research activity, breast cancer in young women, focusing on clinical data, particularly for the very young patient group, so women under the age of 35 years. Before going to my presentation, I have just one voting slide, just to set the scene on this topic. So in the care of breast cancer in young women under the age of 35 years old at the time of diagnosis, which of the following is the correct answer? Number one, adjuvant or neoadjuvant chemotherapy should be always administered. Second, indication to genetic testing depends on family history and or tumor biology. Number three, age per se is not a reason to administer more aggressive therapies. And number four, only selected patients can be offered fertility preservation strategies. So please vote. And while waiting for the results, I just wanted to say that in the next 50...
Да, я буквально 40 секунд у нас уходит.
It takes us some 40 seconds to do the voting. Colleagues, there is only one correct answer. The rest are not correct. We need to make to find a correct answer. First option, always. Adjuvant or neoadjuvant chemotherapy should be prescribed. Second, indications for genetic testing depend on family history and biology of tumor. Just the age is not a reason to use more aggressive methods of treatment. And number four, only some selected patients are offered strategies with preservation of fertility. Very cunning questions from Professor Matteo. So we wait for the results of voting. Matteo will announce the results within seconds.
Before starting the presentation.
За третий вопрос проголосовали 41.
Number three received 41%. Just the age is not a reason to prescribe a more aggressive therapy. Спасибо.
I really hope that we convince the 60% that did not vote for number three that this is the correct answer to this question. So now moving to the presentation, I know that I have only 15 minutes, so I'm just gonna give some few highlights on four important topics when we discuss breast cancer in young women and when we manage breast cancer in young patients. So why it's important to discuss this topic? Because breast cancer is the most commonly diagnosed tumor in young patients. This is a very nice epidemiology paper published in the Lancet Oncology a few years ago, showing the distribution of different cancer types in female and male patients diagnosed under the age of 40. And as we can see, breast cancer, the pink color, is the most commonly diagnosed all over the world. We can estimate that 30%, so one out of three new cancer diagnoses in women under the age of 40 is a breast cancer. And this is the reason why international societies, the European School of Oncology, and now together in a joint effort with the European Society for Medical Oncology, are organizing every 2 years a very important international conference where all the major experts in the field meet to try to give us guidelines on how to improve the care of young women with breast cancer. So if you are managing your clinic, breast cancer in young patients, please refer to the BCY guidelines to be up to date on what should be done. And most of my presentation is going to be focused on the recommendations given by the BCY guidelines, the last published last year in Annals of Oncology in 2020. So first topic, biology of breast cancer in young patients. we tend to think that breast cancer arising in young women is more aggressive as compared to tumors arising in older patients. It's true that if we look at the pathologic breast cancer subtype definition, as well as the molecular subtype definition, so using immunohistochemistry or gene expression profiling, in both cases, we see that young patients have higher risk of developing more aggressive tumor subtypes, triple negative, HER2 positive subtypes. But it's also important to highlight that the majority of young women still develop luminal-like cases, so hormone receptor positive breast cancer. But it's interesting to note that within the group of hormone receptor positive disease, the majority of the cases have a luminal B-like biology, so more aggressive feature, with around 10% of cases with a luminal A-like biology, so less aggressive tumors, which is less than half as compared to what happens in older patients, where the luminal A-like subtype is more than 20%. Several studies have addressed the potential prognostic value of young age at diagnosis. This is one of the largest studies showing that young age remains a poor prognostic factor, even after correcting for all the potential confounding factors, as you can see in the last column. So stage of diagnosis, tumor subtype, treatment received, still young age retain a negative prognostic value. Being diagnosed under the age of 40 years is associated with a 30% greater breast cancer mortality as compared to being diagnosed between the age of 51 and 60 years, irrespective of all the other characteristics, patient, tumor, and treatment characteristics. But the most important results of this study is the prognostic value of young age at diagnosis broken down according to the pathologic breast cancer subtypes, showing that the negative prognostic value of young age at diagnosis appears to remain mostly observed for the luminal-like cases, so for patients with hormone receptor positive disease. There are different clinical and biological explanations for these findings. We don't have the time to go in depth into this topic, but here I just wanted to highlight that even if young women have higher risk of triple negative and HER2 positive disease, still the majority of cases are hormone receptor positive tumors. And among these tumors, the majority of them have a luminal B-like biology. And irrespective of their biology, we have to consider that the prognosis of young women with hormone receptor positive disease appears to be worse as compared to older patients. So we have to pay particular attention to the adjuvant endocrine therapy in this patient population. I'm going to address that later on in my presentation. A few slides on genetic testing and hereditary cancer syndromes. This is key. This is a key aspect in the care of young women with breast cancer. According to our guidelines, genetic testing should be offered to all women diagnosed under the age of 40 years, irrespective of family history, tumor biology, or other characteristics. So age per se is a reason to send the patient to genetic testing, at least for the BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes. The reason is that the incidence of pathogenic variants in BRCA is quite high in young patients. We can estimate it's between 12 and 15% if we take women under the age of 40 years, and we can think that it can be even higher in patients under the age of 35 years. And when we find a BRCA pathogenic variants in young patients, there are two important information that we should share with our patient. The first one is that carrying a BRCA pathogenic variant has no negative prognostic value. So a young woman with BRCA mutations has similar outcomes as a young woman without BRCA mutation. And there is no difference in terms of prognostic value between BRCA1 and BRCA2, similar prognosis. However, again, going back to the topic of hormone receptor positive disease in a young patient, we see that among BRCA mutated patients, hormone receptor status has no prognostic value. Actually, patients with hormone receptor negative disease and BRCA mutation appears to have better outcomes as compared to young women with BRCA mutation having hormone receptor positive disease. So hormone receptor positivity does not appear to be a positive prognostic factor in young patients carrying a germline BRCA pathogenic variant. Testing for BRCA has clear therapeutic implications, not only in terms of risk-reducing strategies. We all know the value of mastectomy as well as prophylactic gynecological surgery in this setting. But now, having a BRCA mutation has also clear therapeutic implications from a medical oncology standpoint. We have several PARP inhibitors that have entered clinical use also for breast cancer, with olaparib and talazoparib approved for the treatment of patients with germline BRCA mutation and advanced disease, metastatic disease. Few weeks ago, we had the presentation of the Olympia trial results and simultaneous publication in the New England Journal of Medicine showing the extraordinary results of giving this drug for a year following adjuvant or neoadjuvant chemotherapy in patients with high-risk early breast cancer carrying germline BRCA mutation. Almost 9% absolute gain in invasive disease-free survival at 3 years for the olaparib arm as compared to placebo following standard adjuvant or neoadjuvant chemotherapy. We are talking about young patients. One important clinical implication to be considered for these findings as soon as we will have available olaparib in our clinical practice. We know that BRCA mutated patients have a high pregnancy desire. In our study published in JCO last year, we showed that up to 20% of young women with breast cancer carrying germline BRCA mutation had a post-treatment pregnancy. We also know that carrying a germline BRCA mutation gives some reproductive disadvantage to women, so they having a BRCA mutation appears to be associated with a reduced fertility potential, with a reduced ovarian reserve, even before starting anti-cancer therapy. And we also know that PARP inhibitors, and specifically olaparib, can be gonadotoxic, can deplete the ovarian reserve in mouse experiments. So far, there is no evidence in humans on this aspect, but taking all these findings into account, we have to pay real attention on what happens in terms of fertility and pregnancy implication with the addition of 1 year of olaparib on the top of adjuvant or neoadjuvant chemotherapy in the specific cohort of BRCA mutated patients. And we are also working in this field. Moving to probably the most important topic for breast cancer young patients, which is the use of adjuvant endocrine therapy in women with hormone receptor positive disease. Many news over the past years. 6 years ago, tamoxifen alone was the only standard of care in this setting. 5 years of tamoxifen was the only adjuvant endocrine therapy option for young women, with the possibility to extend to 10 years with tamoxifen in women remaining premenopausal after the first 5 years, or moving to an aromatase inhibitors for between year 5 and 10 for those that turn to be postmenopausal after the first 5 years of tamoxifen. In the last few years, many news in the field. The first is the role of adding ovarian function suppression to tamoxifen. Two important trials, the SOFT study and the ASTRA trial, supporting the beneficial role of adding ovarian function suppression to tamoxifen with a clear advantage in both disease-free survival and overall survival, particularly for high-risk patients like those that receive prior chemotherapy. Notably, in the SOFT trial, OFS was given for 5 years, in the ASTRA trial was given for 2 years. When we add ovarian function suppression to tamoxifen, we increase the side effect of adjuvant endocrine therapy. This is very important to be discussed with our patient. More menopause-related symptoms, more sexual dysfunction, and these side effects are particularly relevant for the very young patient population. And if we do not discuss these side effects, we know that women are less adherent to the treatment, and particularly those very young, diagnosed before the age of 35, tend to stop adjuvant endocrine therapy before the standard duration of 5 years. Almost one quarter, so one out of four young women under the age of 35 stop the treatment, stop the adjuvant endocrine therapy at 4 years, so before the standard duration of 5 years. And this is very important to be discussed. Second important news, the role of combining ovarian function suppression with an aromatase inhibitor. Two trials, the joint analysis of soft and text with OFS for 5 years and exemestane as aromatase inhibitor, and the other trial, the OBO study, that show a beneficial role for the triple combination, OFS, letrozole, and zoledronic acid for 5 years. It's important to highlight that these trials have shown a clear advantage in terms of invasive disease, in terms of disease-free survival, almost 4% increase at 5-8 years in disease-free survival. But so far, there is no advantage in overall survival, and we are waiting for the updated analysis that will be presented probably in San Antonio from the soft and text trials. The combination of OFS plus an aromatase inhibitor has different toxicity profile as compared to OFS plus tamoxifen, with more sexual dysfunction as well as bone or joint pain. And this is the reason why it's highly relevant again to discuss this different toxicity profile with our patient, not only at diagnosis but also during treatment follow-up, and also to offer our patient the possibility to have supportive treatments, pharmacological or non-pharmacological treatments, according to the side effects that they experience with the offer adjuvant endocrine therapy. How to counsel a young patient on the best adjuvant endocrine therapy? The first important point is that for OFS plus an AI, we need to have a complete ovarian suppression to have the aromatase inhibitor working. We know that up to 20% of premenopausal women are not completely suppressed with OFS plus an AI, and the very young age, so below the age of 35, is one of the risk factors for not being completely suppressed, together with not receiving chemotherapy or high BMI, body mass index. If we have a patient very young, high BMI, and not receiving chemotherapy, this is not the best candidate for OFS plus an AI. And this implies that for patients receiving OFS plus an AI, especially the very young patient population, we need to carefully follow them, especially during the first year, also with estradiol regular checking to be sure that they are completely suppressed. Based on this data, current guidelines support the use of OFS plus tamoxifen or an AI in high-risk patients, without strong preference for tamoxifen over an AI. To make this choice, which treatment to be given, the soft and text authors have produced this free online tool that is available online without paying any access to the website. Thanks to this composite risk score, the author have estimated the prognosis of patients based on the classical clinical pathological characteristics that we normally use to make our treatment choices. And according to this composite risk score, we have on one side patients with very good prognostic features, almost 100% freedom from distal recurrences at 8 years. And on the other side, patients with the worst survival outcomes, very high disease, high risk features, and in the middle patient with intermediate risk characteristics. And the authors have applied the results of the soft and text trial using these composite risk scores. And what they have shown is that patients with low risk of this recurrence have no benefit from adding OFS or an aromatase inhibitor, so tamoxifen alone, still standard of care in this setting, while patients at high risk of the recurrence, and particularly the higher the risk of recurrence, the larger the benefit expected with OFS plus an AI over OFS plus tamoxifen. So how to choose the best adjuvant endocrine therapy? In my practice, what I do, I start from the Regan risk score, so with this online tool. For patients at low risk of this recurrence, I do not give chemotherapy and I give tamoxifen alone. No gene expression profiling is needed for this choice. The same on the other side, high risk patient, I give chemotherapy and I give the best endocrine therapy option, OFS plus an AI. Again, no gene expression profiling is needed. For patients in the gray zone for chemotherapy administration, I may use gene expression profiling to decide if to give or not chemotherapy. The main point in this intermediate risk group is that if I decide to give chemotherapy, it does not really make a difference if I give tamoxifen or an aromatase inhibitor together with OFS. On the contrary, if I give chemotherapy, if I do not give chemotherapy, I tend to prefer the best endocrine treatment option, which is OFS plus an AI. Very few final words, if I have two more minutes, on the last but very important topic for breast, for young women, particularly those under the age of 35, fertility and pregnancy-related issues. This is a higher priority for many women. It's one of the top three priorities according to Young Women Advocates. However, despite this high interest, we know that only a small proportion of young breast cancer survivors conceive following treatment completion for breast cancer. And among cancer survivors, those with prior history of breast cancer have the lowest chances of future pregnancy, more than 60% reduced likelihood of having a subsequent pregnancy as compared to the general population of a similar age. Two main explanations. The first one is the gonotoxicity of the treatment we give to cure breast cancer, and so the need to refer patients to fertility preservation strategies, cryopreservation options, as well as use of ovarian suppression during chemotherapy. Second important explanation for this very low pregnancy rate are the concerns shared by many patients and physicians that a pregnancy in breast cancer survivors, being breast cancer a hormonally driven form of tumor, may have a detrimental effect on the prognosis of patients. When we ask the question to breast cancer specialists if they believe that pregnancy is safe in breast cancer survivors, one third of responding physicians was not sure that pregnancy is safe, and this percentage went up to almost 50%, so one out of two responding physicians, if the same question was referred to BRCA carriers. However, the data we have so far do not support these concerns. Large meta-analysis showing clearly that patients with pregnancy after breast cancer have no detrimental outcomes, or actually have better outcomes than those without pregnancy. This is also the case for patients with hormone receptor positive disease, no difference between those with or without a subsequent pregnancy. And this is also the case for BRCA carriers, with better disease-free survival for BRCA carriers with a subsequent pregnancy as compared to those without a pregnancy following, of course, adequate treatment and follow-up for breast cancer. We are waiting for the results of the positive trial that will tell us if it's safe to stop endocrine treatment in the first 5 years for a maximum duration of 2 years to allow women to have a pregnancy before completing the standard duration of endocrine therapy, which is 5 years. So my conclusion are that breast cancer arising in young women is biologically different, and these differences goes beyond a different distribution in breast cancer subtypes. Age per se is not a reason to give more aggressive therapies. All young women should be offered genetic counseling before starting treatment. Adjuvant endocrine therapy and the best choice in terms of adjuvant endocrine therapy is one of the most sensitive and important issues to be discussed with young patients. Fertility and pregnancy-related issues are also of crucial importance, and the oncofertility counseling is considered mandatory, and diagnosis should be done with all women. Pregnancy after breast cancer is safe, of course, after adequate treatment and follow-up, also in patients with hormone receptor positive and carrying BRCA pathogenic variants. And with that, I wish to thank you for your attention, and again, to Tatiana and all the organizing committee for the invitation.